It's time for the Phil Ferguson Show.
Everybody, this is another one of those special shows that I guess I've done a couple times now where it doesn't follow the normal piecemeal format, which maybe everybody loves of the show, but it's going to mostly be about this interview, and it's in part because of the time-sensitive nature of all of this information. I have with me Ray Smock, and he is the former historian for the House of Representatives. Did I get that correct?
That's right.
And you were also, I don't know the title, president, executive director of the Byrd Library Collection?
Yeah. Director of the Robert C. Byrd Center for Congressional History and Education. Did that for 16 years, built that institution, which studies Congress and has collections of major figures, including Senator Byrd, the longest serving senator in U.S. history.
Excellent. And of course, the job with the House of Representatives as a historian, how long did you do that, and what exactly did you do?
Well, I was the first one, and I was there for almost 12 years, and I served in the offices of three speakers of the House, Tip O'Neill, Jim Wright of Texas, and Tom Foley of Washington State. And and my job then initially was to plan for the 200th anniversary celebration of the Constitution, the Congress, and the Bill of Rights, and to establish a history office for the House that they never had before, because Congress is misunderstood, as all three branches are. There's plenty of presidential historians out there. They're almost a dime a dozen, but not that many congressional experts.
Absolutely. And, of course, we'll talk about some of your newer books in a moment, but you've written some big, detailed historical analysis books in the past. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, when Donald Trump was elected president, something in the pit of my stomach sank, not because a Republican succeeded a Democrat. It was much more fundamental than that, because Donald Trump simply didn't know or understand how government works. And so the only way that he could act was as he's acted his entire life, as a dictator, as a boss, as someone who pushed people around, and if they didn't like him, he sued them. So that was the basis for me starting a bearing witness through essays, mostly posted on Facebook and also occasionally as op-ed pieces in newspapers, where I discussed in a historical context, what was going on at that particular moment. I was a historian, but I was trying to respond in real time. That's usually the role of journalists, but I wanted the historical perspective. So I ended up writing three books in over the last almost 5 years now on Donald Trump. The third one, which I think is perhaps the best, it just came out a month ago, and it's called Bearing Witness to America's Worst President. So and these are available on Amazon. The idea being that there's no question that he's the worst president, but saying that is one thing, and then documenting and analyzing why. And trying to explain it to people. That was my goal.
Yeah, and it sounds like at least 30% of the population needs to read your book.
Well, it was amazing. I did think that Trump's support base would stay with him. I didn't think that it would almost double in size. The only thing that so far, we will analyze this election for years to come, but the best thing, best explanation I can think of right now for why he got over 70 million votes was that his entire presidency was one continuous campaign rally. He never really governed. He rallied. He campaigned. He's the first president ever to file for re-election on the day of his inauguration, when he was first inaugurated.
Right.
And he did that so that he could raise vast quantities of money instantly, not wait for a campaign. We used to have a campaign season. Now it's constant campaigning.
Well, and of course, I'm assuming in a few days here, or at least in January, if he hasn't already, he's going to initiate his campaign for 2024. Or did I miss that and it's already started?
It's already started. I don't know. By all accounts, many of us saw this early on, and others have come to it more recently. The president is mentally unstable, and so he's flaying around right now. If he wants, he's thinking of a way that he's got to defeat Biden, because Biden defeated him. So how do you do that? Well, you run again, and you show that his election, that Biden's election, was a fluke, and that the people really wanted him all along. It's that kind of personal ego trip that has dominated his whole attempt to brand himself. The Trump brand is the most important thing in the world to him and his family, and how else to continue the brand except that I'm going to continue to be around. I'm not going to be quiet as the next president. I'm going to make a lot of noise, and I'm going to get this office back.
I just recently saw a little interview with John Bolton. I'm sure you know who he is.
Yes.
And he said that the big mistake that Trump is making is focusing on himself and not the Republican Party. And I was screaming at the screen at that moment, because the big problem is not that Trump is focused on himself instead of the Republican Party. The problem is that Trump and the Republican Party are focused on the Republican Party, not the administration and the security and the welfare of Americans. They're worried about their party. They're worried about the election. They're not worried about the people. Am I misreading that, especially in light of Mitch McConnell, or do you have a different take on that?
No, I think you're right about that, Phil. There's no evidence that the Republican Party is thinking of the country at all, other than their own power. This is most troubling to me. Trump, you can understand him in his own peculiar context, but to think how he managed to capture an entire political party, and how that party, even though he has lost the presidency, continues to be afraid of him. What they're afraid of is that his base of support, if he gets out there and after he's out of office and starts running down Mitch McConnell, starts running down all of the leaders of the Republican Party, that this will hurt them. And they're already thinking about the off-year elections in 2022. Aside from the fact there are those in the Republican Party who are already planning these things. These things run on huge cycles that the public doesn't really focus on very much, but people are already lining up to figure out who's going to be the president in 2024. And if this big gorilla is still sitting in the middle of the road, how is anybody going to get around him? They know what happened last time. All the candidates that came up against Trump, the Republicans, there were some very reasonable people in there, the John Kasichs of the world and others, and Jeb Bush. And Trump, because of his braggadocio and his uncharacteristic, presidential style, he blew all those guys off the stage. That's what they're afraid of, that even as the next president, he will still be able to blow them right off the stage. And that scares the devil out of them.
Yeah, I think if anything that he's actually good at, it's marketing showmanship, his ability to attack people and tear them down. It's not presidential. It's not business. It's not professional business, but it appeals, sadly. And then maybe this is our real problem, is that a large chunk of the American population is willing to watch shows like where he would hire and fire people, and watch shows where 30 women try to get a rose from one handsome young man in the hopes that they can get married. And people watch these shows and think that they're kind of real. And the lack of education, the lack of information, the willingness to think that there's this massive ring of pedophilia with QAnon and Pizzagate. And when Trump comes out and says there's this massive voter fraud, people generally, I know I didn't know the nuance and the details of these certifications and how it takes weeks and months to go through. And so there's plenty of room to confuse people. What do you think about what's going on in Pennsylvania and Michigan?
Well, these frivolous suits. There are some technical things that really are important to think about for future elections, but won't change this election. I mean, we had so many mail-in ballots, and then what people some people did who were confused by the mail-in ballot process. Some of them actually forgot if they mailed it in or not, and if it got there, and so they would show up at the polls. And until the polling places had a chance to check to see if their mail-in ballot was there and it was valid, they would get a provisional ballot, and they would be able to vote provisionally. Those ballots then would be counted afterwards, and they would be matched up. So there were some small technical difficulties and challenges because of the unprecedented nature of all the mail-in ballots. A lot of states are used to this. They do it routinely. Other states were making new exceptions because of the COVID, where you used to have a medical reason to get a mail-in ballot, and they just waived all that. So there was lots of changes. But none of that resulted in any fraud. It resulted in some accounting technicalities that wouldn't change any election in any state. And that's what they're playing with now.
Yeah,
that'll be thrown out, and the states will be certified. But here, if you want to scare your listeners, Bill,
just a little.
Let me suggest this: the certification process and the counting of the electoral votes. I used to be on the floor and watch this in person. On January 6th, the House will meet in joint session. To actually open the certified ballots from the states that are sealed and mailed to the National Archives and also mailed to the Clerk of the House and the Secretary of the Senate. And then they will gather and they will open these up and actually certify on January 6th the actual final count. That's usually a ceremonial event. Guess who presides over that event?
Mitch McConnell?
Mike Pence.
Oh,
Mike Pence.
Oh my God.
Mike Pence is he's Vice President of the United States, but he's President of the Senate. So Mike Pence and Nancy Pelosi will sit in the seats and they will preside over this joint session. Usually it's a quiet thing and very few members even show up. You have a few tellers, senators and House members, Republicans and Democrats, who line up in front. The ballots are passed down to them. They slice them open and they certify that the count is what the state said it was. And that's routine, but it's the final step. And 2 weeks later, you have the inauguration. This year, members can come to this thing and they can object to the certification. And usually those things are waived off. Sometimes members like to get up and say something wonderful about their state of Michigan or whatever.
Right.
So it's kind of a ceremonial, kind of a fun thing. Sometimes people cheer in the galleries when someone says, the state of Arizona votes so-and-so, and they cheer. Now, you're not supposed to cheer, but usually they don't. It doesn't matter. They let it go. It's very casual, laid back. This time, I think it's going to be deadly serious. I think a lot of members will show up. And I think that the last time that there's chicanery afoot will not be until January 6th.
Wow. Yeah, that could be a giant circus. And, of course, in Trumpian style, the more circus-like, the better, because that means viewership. And that's how he judges anything he does, I think, is power, wealth, recognition, adoration. Adoration is probably the driving factor, but I don't think anyone, maybe you know of somebody. I don't know of anyone in history who has lost more legal battles in such a short period of time as the last couple of weeks with Trump and his clown car of attorneys.
It's been very sad to see, and it's more than a sadness, and it's more than the circus that we're playing. There's been, there's only 50 states, but there's been 35 lawsuits. 24 of them have been dismissed already. The other 12 are relatively minor things. There's, as we said, Michigan's and Pennsylvania are the last big serious ones. A little bit of things in Wisconsin yet. But that'll all pass. And when you think about it, that's part of Trump's modus operandi and has been all his life. He's been involved in more than 3,500 lawsuits throughout his career, most of which, some of which he won, most of which he lost. He approaches everything as a legal transaction. And so all of these initial charges of fraud were just simply for public consumption. Once they got into the actual courtroom, they had to try to argue something different because it couldn't be fraud. At one point, Rudy Giuliani even said yes. to a federal judge, "This is not about fraud." He had to say that. When he goes out in front of the public, he says, "This is fraud." When he goes in before a judge in a court of law, he has to change his tune. But all of these legal people are being paid by Trump to express themselves. They're trying to find an angle, but there's no angle when your client is crazy.
Yeah, it's a routine pattern where he agrees to a deal and then he disagrees to it. And I many years ago had a boss that was like Trump, where he would lie, he would cheat, he would steal people's work, he would belittle people in a meeting, people outside of a meeting. Was just a sociopathic, horrific person. But almost half of the office thought he was a genius and they were willing to put up with it because he was so smart and doing this, you know, four-dimensional chess kind of thing where he was just really a bully and an idiot. And so as I became aware of Trump, I was like, there's another one of this 1% of the population maybe, or a tenth of 1% that is just nuts and they will do anything and everything they can for number one, for themselves, and nothing else matters, and how it happens doesn't matter. And I see that playing out like you kind of indicated. I'll say it more forcefully that this was not really a surprise. I mean, this fits the modus operandi of Donald Trump, and this is the way he is, and this is the way he will be, and this is the way he will be the next 4 years unless he's in jail, and he'll still be that way from jail.
Yes, and if you recall the election of 1920, I'm sure that's on top of your mind. In that election, Eugene Debs was in jail, and he got a million votes running from as a socialist in the 1920 presidential campaign. And someone asked me recently if you could run for president from jail. Yes, you could. It's happened before.
Yeah, I was just gonna say there's no rule to prevent you from running from president while incarcerated.
No, there is not.
Yeah.
The Constitution is silent on that matter. The Constitution never expected that someone in jail would be even considered as a presidential candidate. But millions of people voted for this man in 2016. I guess they didn't know that he had just, and it was public before he was elected, he settled a $25 million fraud suit with his Trump University.
Yes.
He was known as someone who was fraudulent, but that didn't stop people from voting for him.
Yeah, and I regularly did segments on Trump's financial performance over the years, even using his numbers, which are complete fiction. When I used Trump's numbers, he significantly materially underperformed the S&P 500. So the amount of money he got from his dad in the 60s and 70s, if he had just put that in the market and done nothing, he would be wildly richer than he is now, because I'm not sure that his net value is above zero, but I don't have all those details. Maybe nobody does, not even him. But it's all a show. It's all a con and keeping What, the three card Monty? You never really know what's afoot with this guy.
I think that's the case. A lot of this we know already, and you know, usually we don't really fully understand a presidential administration till years afterwards. And some presidents have been down in popularity, and then they've come back in popularity. And as we learn things, and as the world plays out, and we see that they were really smarter on this subject than we thought they were at the time. I can say with almost full confidence that Donald Trump will always remain, I hope he always remains, the worst president. I hope we never get one that's worse. He is simply the worst that we've ever had by any measure of presidential behavior and performance. And yet, I'm very worried about the country, as a lot of people are. The fact that he could still garner the second largest number of votes in a presidential contest. He lost considerably, by almost, looks like Biden might have 6 to 7 million more votes when all the counting is done and everything is finalized. So it's a substantial popular vote. But the fact that Trump managed to get over 70 million is really troublesome about how we have failed to present the importance of American politics, the importance of government. I think a lot of people just don't like government. They don't like paying taxes. They don't want anything to do with it. And
yeah,
that is the attitude that drives their votes.
Yeah.
And that's sad, because government is important and it's necessary.
Yeah, absolutely, for so many things. One of the things that inspired me to call you today, although I've been thinking about it for weeks, in the Washington Post, brand new story, a statement from 100 or more, I guess it's more than 100, former national security officials. Most of them, I think, were Republicans, served in and for Republican administrations at the top levels of the government. Some of them were actually elected officials, and they put out a letter that's quite vigorously insistent that Trump needs to concede now and start the transition, and that he lost, and that not only does he need to go, but he's actually harming democracy. Any thoughts on that document?
Yes, I saw that, and it is a remarkable document from a wonderfully talented group of American patriots. And when you get to that level of government, when you're the national security advisor, when you're the Secretary of State, when you're all these very important top positions, you know, party is not the issue. It shouldn't never be the issue. You're working for the country. Anybody in the military is not about political parties. The military is about defending the country and upholding their oath to the Constitution. I saw, when I worked for government, the great joy of seeing people who were dedicated to their country, and they were from both parties, and you didn't even bring up party
right
when you were with them or talked to them. It's not an issue. And yet Trump has made party everything. So these individuals understand that Donald Trump, in not having a smooth transition, which has been the hallmark of American government transfer of power, it's been a model for the whole world, how well we do it. We fight like hell, and then when the election is over, we accept it and we welcome the new person into the office, because that represents what the people have authorized through their vote, the most important thing. So for these gentlemen to suggest that this is a danger to the country, they're talking about national security issues, which are vital. I mean, Biden's people need to get up to speed immediately, because pretty soon they're going to have the football and the nuclear bomb in their little compartment, not in Trump's compartment anymore. This is vital. The other thing is, of course, and a very important part of national security is the pandemic that we're in. and the fact that we're at a crucial point of transition in how we're going to deal with this and how we're going to usher the vaccines out, millions and millions of doses. That's a big, big logistical operation. And Trump is holding all of that up, threatening the country, holding it up, threatening democracy, causing people unnecessarily to die of this COVID because we're not taking the kind of federal action that we need to be taking on this.
Yeah, I just the other day, I was talking to, I guess, a friend, an acquaintance on Facebook. They call them friends, but it's just people I know. And they were concerned that how could a mask stop a virus if it couldn't stop the smell of farts? And the complete and utter lack of understanding of scale, of the size of things in the world, which is probably quite common among the populace, not knowing the difference in size between a molecule, which might be picked up by your nose and we call it a smell, versus the size of a virus, which is several orders of magnitude, hundreds, thousands of times larger. And then, of course, the virus transfers on water droplets, which are wildly larger than that. It was just mind-boggling to me that they didn't have the least bit of understanding about the scale of things in our world, in our modern world. I don't know if you're familiar with Carl Sagan's book, Candle in the Dark, where he talks about the pending danger of our future, where our technology is beyond the comprehension of the average citizen, creates a potential problem. Any thoughts on that rambling?
Carl Sagan's book, it was his last book in 1995. He knew he was dying, and he wanted to leave a message to the future world, and that is that despite all the wonders of science, and all the tremendous advances that we've made in science, that the human race was basically still demon-haunted, superstitious, uninformed about science, and that this dichotomy, that we're in the era of the greatest scientific advancements in the history of humankind, and at the same time, the majority of humans throughout the world are still engaged in superstitious behaviors. They're afraid to give their children vaccinations. They're worried about all kinds of religious concepts that keep them from acting scientifically. All of this is what Carl Sagan warned us about. He wasn't thinking of a pandemic in particular, but the pandemic has brought out the superstition, the fear, the lack of understanding, and as you say, no sense of scale about how this virus is transmitted. It's transmitted between people on air droplets and in breath and in sneezes and in coughs. That's how you get it. And if you're wearing a mask, your chances of getting it drop to 1%. So if everybody in the United States wore a mask, we wouldn't be in this terrible spike that's probably going to last for the next couple of months. Because we still feel like we have to gather for Thanksgiving,
yes.
And we still think that we have to gather for this wonderful religious thing at Christmas time, our demon past, I don't know, our superstitions, our religions actually work against us at times like this, and that's what Carl Sagan was trying to tell us.
Absolutely, another thing I think is very common. I don't want to be too negative, but a lot of people, I'll say, where everything is a dichotomy, even when it's not a dichotomy. For example, you just said that, maybe the chances of getting COVID fall to 1% if both parties are wearing a mask, where there are people who literally put up posts that say, well, there's this one case where this one guy went and sat in a restaurant with 20 people and he didn't eat and he had his mask on the whole time and he still got COVID, so masks don't work. But they improve your probabilities, just like a vaccination. Getting a vaccination doesn't mean you're guaranteed to never get ill from that specific illness. It dramatically reduces the probability, and if you do get ill, it is likely to dramatically reduce the symptoms that you get from that because your body has already fought that illness. But people don't seem to understand that. maybe we should spend a couple of billion dollars educating people on what a fucking virus is and how it's transmitted and how a vaccination works before we start rolling this thing out so that everyone will want to take it.
There's going to be, you know, just like there's mask objection, there will be inoculation objection.
Oh, I know it.
That's we'll have to play that out. They're going to have public advertising campaigns. You're going to have to get celebrities that everybody seems to like, rock stars, sports figures. They're going to have to be shown getting the vaccination. And someone will say, "Well, my favorite quarterback just got it. I guess I'll try it. What the hell?" It's down to that level, and it's this time. It's at times like this that I lament the fact that all of our universities, all of our educational systems, from grade school all the way up and into postgraduate stuff, and all the medical science that goes on, that somehow we haven't been able to spread that more widely among the Earth's population, and here in the United States, where every opportunity is afforded most people to get at least a modicum of education, or and yet I don't know what we're educating them about, educating them for vocations that quickly disappear, and not educating them about humanity, about science, about some morals, ethics. The kinds of things that endure in all societies, in all civilizations, and yet we seem to, the Trump administration has brought home with great clarity how far we have to go to be able to advance and to deal with the things that the whole planet is facing in our lifetime, not in some future.
Yeah.
Far off place, but in the next 20, 30, 40, 50 years.
One thing that just popped in my head, I want to circle back. The president, when a newly elected president, how many positions, jobs, is the president, the executive branch, how many people are they responsible for? I mean, is it like 50 people, 100 people? What do you think? You probably have a better feel for that than me.
Well, when a president comes into office, he has the senior executive service, and a lot of those people are you know, people who continue on. There's some jobs in the government. The president has the right to fire them technically, but usually doesn't if they're performing their job. The FBI director is supposed to have a 10-year service. Well, you know, Trump has violated that a couple of times, and he's liable to go after the current FBI director again. Other positions, Biden understands this. He will keep people in power and in offices if they're doing their job, if they have totally politicized, if they become Trump hacks, he will probably get rid of them. But it's several thousand jobs that a new president can eventually work through, plus the fact that he nominates all future judges and replacements of judges. Judges are retiring, judges die. So there's this constant pool and turnover of people that the executive branch basically handles. And if they're at certain levels, they have to have the advice and consent of the United States Senate. But he doesn't change the whole government. No president does. The only thing that has kept this country from collapsing is the fact that we have, in the government workforce, we have a lot of competent people who simply do their jobs every day at every level, in the military and in the civilian side. They're down a little bit below Donald Trump's radar, and luckily they are. He calls them the deep state, where all these Obama holdovers are causing him trouble. Just the opposite is true. People from various administrations, going back to the Bush administration, they're still in jobs, doing their job, having a career, working 20, 30 years for the government. Those are the people who are the real patriots who've kept this country afloat during this assault by Donald Trump.
One of the thoughts that pops in my head when we're talking about jobs is often people are put in the position to do something that the president has commanded, ordered, or, you know, through some other intermediary, they're told the president wants, and they have to do something that against their conscience, and often they choose to take the what I think is a noble path. Don't get me wrong, to resign instead of doing something that they think is inappropriate to such a degree that they are compelled to leave their job. But the unfortunate part is each time one of those people that has a conscience leaves, they're replaced often by someone who doesn't give a shit and who's willing to do Trump's bidding. And of course, my big concern was that if Trump had four more years, it wouldn't continue like this. It would just continue to get worse and worse and incrementally and acceleratingly worse. What do you think about that?
Four more years of Donald Trump would have corroded the government beyond any reasonable chance that we could recover it. And I'm not, it's that bad. And he still has people in government, like the head of the General Service Administration, who can't, who won't do her duty under the law. Now, the law doesn't have any penalty attached to it.
Right.
It just says that the Office of General Service Administrator will ascertain a presidential candidate has a chance of winning. They don't have to have won. They don't have to have the certification. They're supposed to start a transition right after the election. And some aspects of the transition even go on before, once there are candidates for president in the opposite party. So this is a long process, and the GSA administrator, the current person, is obviously taking orders directly from Trump not to do her normal duty. This should be routine. It is not a matter of a political decision. It is a matter that here is a candidate, and the transition is underway, and we have a certain time period. And the fact that she is not doing her duty, she's supposed to go, I think, before Congress today to talk about or to be held accountable. I'm not sure how that will play out or whether Trump will order her not to appear. He's done that many times in the past where he's told government officials not to appear before Congress. That's a violation of law as well. But again, no penalties particularly attached to it. It's just not the way to do business.
Yeah, and it's funny because I think one of the things that I actually quite dislike that Trump has done is the acting administrator, acting executive for this department or that department. But since he's shown that to be a viable path, unfortunately, I think Biden is going to have to use the crap out of that, especially if Republicans keep the Senate, because Mitch McConnell will not certify anybody.
It's going to be a touchy situation in the Senate because Mitch McConnell may not have this time around the kind of lockstep that he had. He's going to have to find ways to cooperate with Joe Biden. Joe Biden knows Mitch McConnell, has known him for 30, 40 years. They're old war horses, both of them. And McConnell's not going to have the iron grip because he will not have the presidency. And if just a few Republicans like Romney and a few others don't go along with his majority, he won't be able to block Biden's appointees. So we're going to have to see how that plays out. I'm not so worried about Mitch McConnell this time around. Once we get past the transition and once we get everything rolling in a new administration, he's still going to be the guy to get around, no question. But I don't think his power is going to be as great as when Trump was in the White House.
Oh, from your lips to my ears, I guess, right? And of course, there's still the possibility that in Georgia, two Democrats could win those two undecided Senate positions. And matter of fact, I think, correct me here if I'm wrong, Trump just attacked one of the Republicans that's running for office as somehow defrauding or tricking the other Republican or stealing votes from the other Republican that was going to run.
All eyes are on Georgia. No question about it. It is that tight. I don't know. I try to follow these things, but I'm not cognizant of all the things that are going on in Georgia right now. The fact that Georgia went Democratic this time was a really important thing to break the iron grip of the Republican Party on the South. And whether or not, and of course I attribute a lot of that to Stacey Abrams and all her work, plus Absolutely. A lot of folks in Georgia.
Yeah.
That play, and I also think in 2022 and in 2024, Texas is going to flip. So the world is getting set up for a future in the 20s and 2030s, where a lot of the demographic shifts that are going on in the country are finally going to pay off. This, what we may be witnessing right now, Phil, is the last gasp of the old order, and how the Republican Party can accommodate the new order will determine whether they even remain as a viable political party going forward. But in Georgia right now, that's a bellwether. And if both those senators end up in the Democratic camp, that would be a further sign. But even if they split and they do one of each, that's a victory.
Well, it definitely would be a victory. And of course, if it's 49-51 with the Republicans in charge, it only takes a deal with one Republican to make it 50-50. Two Republicans, now theoretically you could pass something, but doesn't the Senate have the 60 vote rule thing now that is a nightmare? Or good
no,
thing?
They virtually eliminated that on okay. everything except certain budgetary matters. There is still it's called the Byrd Rule, named for Robert C. Byrd, who was longtime chairman of the Senate Appropriations Committee after his leadership in the Senate. But the Byrd Rule is not just a rule; it's law. It's codified that if you're going to change any kind of a budget process where you're going to increase the national debt, you have to have a 60 votes. Most of the things that the Senate will do will be by the simple majority. They've eliminated the filibuster in a lot of things, including judicial appointments and even Supreme Court appointments. But the 60 vote thing still requires that has to do with the appropriations that increase the national debt, the budget matters. So that still requires 60 votes. So for most things that Mitch McConnell will be trying to do, he will have a razor-thin majority to work with. And in the case of a tie vote in the Senate, of course, then Vice President Kamala Harris will be the tie-breaking vote. She can only vote when there's a tie in the Senate. But she will be the President of the Senate in addition to Vice President of the United States. So it's going to be very touchy and a very tricky business to have that razor-thin majority. And we'll see how effective Mitch McConnell is in trying to continue to make the issues that are facing the whole nation into simply dirty party battles rather than party battles for the good of the nation.
Sure, sure. Another question that popped in my head, and I think I know the answer, but I'm going to leave it ambiguous. So you're not correcting me in case I'm wrong, but let's say that thing on January 6th that the Congress can't get their shit together and they don't certify the election and nobody wins. Does that mean Trump stays?
I can't imagine that as a reasonable scenario, even though right now we're all just hanging on tenterhooks, wondering if this is going to work out or not, and if Trump's going to go away quietly. I think he's just about shot his wad, and he has no legal recourse after these frivolous lawsuits are put to rest. And that's going to happen in the next few days. The states will start certifying. They will start submitting their votes. They have to have them in by December 8th. They're going to set something on December 14th where they have to say that they're all there and everybody's got them. And then they're not opened, as I mentioned earlier, they're not opened until January 6th. By then, I think Trump will have figured out what he's going to do. He's also got to worry about his own self. I think he's going to either pardon himself or have Mike Pence pardon him. He might resign at the last minute in the last hour of his presidency. Rather than face defeat, he will say, "I resign." And then Pence will pardon him and his family of all federal crimes that they may have committed. And boy, they've committed them.
Well, I saw the possibility of Trump taking this line of, actually, I won, but now that I've thought about it some more, the system's so broken and so fraudulent, and since I've fixed everything that there is to fix, I'm just going to go ahead and resign, and Mike Pence is in charge. And then Pence says, "Thank you, Mr. President, for everything you did for us, and I'm going to pardon you and your family."
That sounds pretty wacky. It sounds like we're almost starting to think just like Donald Trump.
Yeah.
But I think that is not an unreasonable scenario, given what he wants to come away with. He's still going to have trouble with state law and with the attorneys in New York State and other places, but he can be pardoned of all the emoluments clause violations, where he managed to make millions of dollars. Him and his family made millions and millions of dollars while he served as president. That's documented.
Yeah.
And Ivanka Trump, with her patents in China and some of the deals that Jared has made, they have raked in a lot of money, not to mention the fact that Trump continues to have this hotel right across from the White House, down the street from the White House, where he forces most people to go to stay so that he can get a profit off of heads of state from foreign countries who come to visit, and he meets them at the Trump International Hotel. This is so blatantly outrageous, but it's never been completely challenged. A lot of people have talked about it. But these are laws that have been violated, constitutional provisions that have been violated, that can be swept away by a pardon. And boy, oh boy, I cannot imagine that he's going to leave office without that pardon.
Well, the curious thing is, he can pardon everyone else in his family. Can he pardon himself? Is there any restriction against that?
There were some legal briefs done when Richard Nixon was in the Watergate days, and his lawyers concluded that there was nothing in the Constitution that prevented the presidential pardon power from extending to the president of pardoning himself. It's never been done. It would be another one of these unprecedented things where Trump goes way over the top just for his own benefit, but that is a distinct possibility.
Wow. We've covered a lot of fun stuff. Is there anything that we haven't gotten to that you think you want to discuss, you want to inform me, you want to make the listeners aware? While you think about that, the books, of course, available on Amazon and any good bookstore. They're under the name Ray Smock. You also have a great books on Booker T. Washington on Raymond W. Smock. So people can look there. The Trump books are fun, easy reads. A lot of them are thoughts in real time, and they are available for like $5 or less. So everybody can go check that out. Any other thoughts that you have?
It's good. It's going to be interesting. This transition is going to continue to play out. I think we're in for a very, very rough winter. Not only because of the transition, but because the COVID is going to continue to spike. Every prediction that all of the professionals made months and months ago is coming true. We see it every day in the charts, and it's nationwide now. It's not isolated. It's not one place versus another not doing as well as it's the whole country's in trouble. So we need to be tough. And bear down and keep our heads screwed on straight during the next few months while all of this plays out. I don't think that Joe Biden is going to be the savior of the planet or the savior of the country. He's going to be a very good president. He's an honorable, decent man. I've watched him his whole career. There's nothing, he represents everything that's fine about the public service. And so that in itself is to me a step in a big step in the right direction.
Absolutely. Many months ago, someone had complained to me that Biden doesn't have a loyal following. And I said, I don't want the man to have a loyal following. I want him to do his fucking job. I want him to show up and actually listen to his advisors, get the briefings about the dangers in the world and the dangers in the United States. I want him to appoint the best people and admit that the people in charge of every one of the departments should know more about that department and will know more about that department than the president, unlike Trump, who knows more than the generals, and put in the right people to do the right jobs and to give him the proper counsel. And when it becomes that rare moment where he, like Bush famously said, is the decider, you know, he will take into account opposing views and make a decision and do his level best. And I kind of fantasize here in my head, and one last scheme for you to opine upon. What if he serves for 2 years and a day and resigns and Kamala becomes president? Can she still run twice for an additional 8 years for a total of 10? How does that rule work?
You have a chance to be president, run for president twice under existing law, and if she for one reason or another became president during Joe Biden's term, she could still run for president twice. Yes, that's true. And that would be true of anybody, but that is in fact the truth, that you have two presidential elections where you run for president. If you inherit another term, that doesn't count as you running for president.
Interesting. Another wacky conspiracy theory kind of idea. Do you think Biden should appoint Obama to the Supreme Court?
I don't know if that's what Obama would want, but I think he would be eminently qualified by every stretch of the imagination to serve. And I don't know who what kind of openings we're going to have on the Supreme Court. And of course, there's been a lot of talk, speculation, mostly silliness, about expanding the court.
Right.
And Joe Biden promised to have a commission look into that. There is nothing, the number of justices on the Supreme Court is not determined by the Constitution. That is a law.
Right.
And we've had anywhere from 6 to 11 justices at different times in our history. You could argue that since the Supreme Court does have a circuit capacity, and that the country has grown, and that the judicial system is overwhelmed, that we could use more judges at all levels, including the Supreme Court.
Yeah, because I could see that being a really compelling argument, that it's not about packing the courts. It's about adjusting the size of the court system to represent the increase in the population. And, you know, in the next 4 years, let's say, we're going to increase the size of the entire system by approximately 25%, which would also affect the Supreme Court. It's not about the Supreme Court, wink, wink, nudge, nudge. It's about the entire system. And I think that might be a reasonable thing to do to try to balance out some of the insane lifetime appointments that have been made over the last 4 years.
That is perfectly within the reason of political discourse. And I think Joe Biden has managed to dodge that bullet during the campaign.
Yeah.
Of course, some of his members of his own party wanted him to say, we got to get rid of this conservative court. And he was caught on the horns of a dilemma. I think he dodged it very successfully by saying, well, we can look into that and we'll have a commission. And the commission may go nowhere, or the commission, as you suggest, Phil, could be the beginning of a reformation that takes maybe 5 to 10 years to accomplish, but that does move us away from some of the extremes that have been caused in recent years.
I did think of one more thing, if you have a few more minutes, if you need to go, sure. I understand. You and I disagree a little bit, and it's a nuanced thing. Electoral college, I am leaning towards it just needs to go away. I think on a post on my Facebook wall, you were indicating more of an adjustment. What do you say about the electoral college?
Well, you know, electoral college, I've had a love-hate relationship with it for many years as I've studied it. What I'm concerned about, we've seen that the system isn't as effective as it should be. But the question is, the simple way to change that was say, oh, well, let's just have a plebiscite. Let's have a vote of the people. And the majority of the nation elects the president, right? Like this time, I mean, my God, Joe gets 80 million votes and Trump gets 72 million votes and he loses. And it's a national a vote. But what that does is it changes the nature of the republic. And it also means that whoever's in control of that one single national election, the chances of fraud are much greater than our diverse, cumbersome, crazy quilt pattern that we have now, which was so crazy quilt that the Russians couldn't figure out how to rig it.
Yeah.
But if you had a nice, smooth, one big voting system where everybody just voted for president, and you totaled up the total numbers at the end of the day, that's a plebiscite. That's a direct vote of the people. That has all kinds in a high tech world that we're living in. That has all kinds of possibilities for fraud and corruption.
Well, what
and
if
it also means that small states would have no reason. The presidents would go to California, Texas, New York, and Illinois, Wisconsin, and they wouldn't have to campaign anywhere else. They wouldn't have to promise anything else because they would go to where the most votes are.
Absolutely. And part of me wonders that if they're going to where the most votes are, wouldn't that represent the most people? To me, the idea that every single time the first two states are Iowa and New Hampshire biases the entire apparatus of our entire government, because you have to go, not that those states don't deserve to be first, but others deserve to be first also. Why not have a rotation? And I think that's controlled by the parties, not by the government per se, but why not have five states selected at random? And then 4 years later, it's a different random five states, but not the first five states. And then, you know, we do that. And over time, every state gets to be one of the first five. But one of my ideas, and of course, this might be a constitutional change, which is very difficult to do, that the small states get one vote for the senator and then one vote or more for the representatives, where they still get some additional power, but not as much as they have now.
The whole system is because of the size of the population, the expansion of our republic. The question is whether the old rules that we invented in the Constitution 230 some years ago are still able to function. And if we do change it, how do we change it to protect the minorities, to protect small states? Do they need to be protected? Or should we go to a direct election? If democracy, you have this thing called democracy, which is majority rule, and you have this thing called a republic, where the people have the power, but the power has to be spread among the people, and some of the states don't have much population to affect anything. So, yeah, these are big issues, and I think that we need to look at all of them, and how we conduct elections, whether the Electoral College survives, and whether or not the Senate should be as undemocratic as it can be when it's not run well. Mitch McConnell ran the Senate by numbers, just like the House runs by numbers, and that's not right. The Senate was supposed to be a place where the minority was protected, where you work things out among the members by consensus and by compromise. If the system breaks down when there's no willingness to compromise, and no willingness to talk across the aisle. The hardened ideology lines have destroyed the Constitution and the way the Senate was established. Excellent. I don't know how we get that back.
Well, much to think about and talk about, and of course, I want to respect your time, and hopefully my listeners enjoyed our lengthy dialogue, and I appreciate you coming on the Phil Ferguson Show very much. Thank you again for your time.
You're welcome, Phil. Always glad to chat with you.
You're listening to the Phil Ferguson Show.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on a mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
Did you have as much fun as I did? I sure enjoy talking to Raymond Smock, former House historian for 12 years, author of multiple books, renowned expert on Booker T. Washington, and of course now, at least in my opinion, an expert on Trump, written 3 books. And like I said, those are easy to read and just fun thoughts, kind of a stream of consciousness edited together from things that he wrote on Facebook, which he's on Facebook, by the way. Raymond Smock wrote these things and put them together and massaged it a little bit. But it's kind of got the, I don't know, kind of a feel like a diary. This happened, then this happened, then this happened. And his understanding of the government and politics and history all kind of woven in. Something I enjoy, maybe it's not for you, but that's okay. You know, we have different things on the show. I didn't expect necessarily to have a show out before Thanksgiving, but here it is, and hopefully you enjoy it. I'll be taking a few extra days to try to not work as much during Thanksgiving, and maybe get a couple shows out in early and mid-December before the Christmas holidays. If you, of course, have ideas or topics you want me to cover in the show, let me know. You know, kind of anything that I normally talk about. If it's an investment question, if it's about politics, if it's about money in general, science, is there somebody you'd like me to interview, a question you would like me to answer or find the answer to? Because there's a lot of things I don't know much about. So I like to have those experts on so that I can learn things and you just happen to kind of hang out and listen to the conversation while Phil gets an education on those topics. It's great fun. So I'm going to wrap up, and I wish you the best and happiest Thanksgiving, and may you have a blessed Christmas season. How's that for you? You didn't expect that. Happy holidays, happy Hanukkah, happy Kwanzaa, whatever it is you choose to celebrate and however you choose to do it. The only thing I ask is that you kind of avoid people for a couple of months, really. You know, I know it's so nice to visit with some families anyway. Not everyone has that luxury of a nice big family to go visit with, but keep the meetings remote. Use something like Zoom or Skype and talk. And I heard someone say, and I don't know who said it, it's much, much better to not visit this one year so that you increase the odds of being able to visit that person for years to come. So think about that. Be safe. And I wish you all the best for the holidays. And I will hopefully next year when we get the vaccines rolling out, we can have some conferences and I can meet you in person then. And until then, ciao.